What I'd like to do is spend the next, oh, 5, 6, 7 minutes introducing my panelists, but introducing them through some immersive experiences in art. So we will be showing you some video over the next few minutes. The video I've gathered in order to help us think about what the role of art in the public sphere is. Can art actually contribute to social justice? Ought art endeavor to contribute to social justice? I can say for myself, just to get the ball rolling, that as a professor at an elite university, a person who has the extraordinary pleasure year after year of teaching sometimes quite distracted 18 to 21 year olds, that not an insignificant question in my mind. Are 18 to 21 year olds actually the ideal audience for? Are they the people constituted best to process the wisdom of art? Or, and here this has led me to my own sort of second chapter in my life, or does the kind of deep, immersive experience that we allow people to have in college belong in the public sphere? Ought we be discussing not only consuming or passively watching, but engaging in vital ways together socially with art? Since the answer I've given to that question myself is yes, I've become more curious as I wandered outside the university about other people who, in a variety of domains, some domains you might not think of as the natural domains of the arts, I've been really curious about how they are doing that. The first person I'm introducing here really needs, I know, no introduction. But for me, David's work is fascinating to study over time in that he seems to be using the 800-word column, perhaps as a kind of, perhaps by stealth, as a medium in which humanistic knowledge is transmitted in very pithy ways. Those of you who read him just in the last week had occasion to think about the difference between myth and parable, and whether we live in a mythic age or an age of the parable. David's commitment to ideas and to the power of art to communicate ideas is what attracted me to him several years ago at Aspen when I asked him, before I had a TV series in motion, when I asked him if he would sit in one of the rooms in the meadows with me, squeezed in with some cameras, and if he would discuss with me W.H. Auden's Musée des Beaux-Arts, a poem that asks us to think about suffering and our relationship to suffering and the artist's special accountability to suffering in the world. So after that lengthy introduction, could we see the first video? This is David and some others in an episode on Musée.
The sun shone as it had to on the white legs disappearing into the green water, and the expensive, delicate ship that must have seen something amazing.
A boy falling out of the sky.
Had somewhere to get to.
And sailed calmly on.
I'm struck by this first line about suffering. They were never wrong, comma. Next line, the old masters. What would have been the difference, I wonder, if he had written, the old masters were never wrong about suffering?
By putting about suffering first, the central character is suffering and not the old masters. It's not like, this is a poem I'm about to teach you about suffering. It's not, I'm not going to give you a poem about who the masters are and how smart they were.
To begin the poem with the word about means that this poem is, it's a kind of opinion poem. It's an attitude poem. And about suffering, this isn't a poem of suffering or in suffering. It's about one's position in relation to suffering. He uses that word position, which is a very cold, abstract word, how well they understood its human position. There's a kind of casualness about that. About suffering, they were never wrong, the old masters. There's a fairly, it's a very civilized tone.
How does that line sit with you?
Well, I love the way he did it.
Why? Why do you love it?
Because it doesn't fundamentally matter. The old masters, I think, you know, refers to the artists and so forth whose paintings moved him. And
the old masters could be philosophers, it could be spiritual guides.
But also their power brokers.
And he had his own suspicions about their highfalutin position as visionaries.
The old masters, they're both part of the description, but also part of the problem.
Are artists part of the problem? How does the artist find a position vis-a-vis the world he or she represents that is transformative or offers healing in some way? I met Carrie Mae Weems very briefly when she received the Du Bois Award at Harvard University, and I asked her then if perhaps we would get together and talk about poems and photography, and I hope we will do that. For today, Carrie provided me a piece of video. Unfortunately, we can't show all of it. It's very beautiful, that she thought represents what's on her mind when we think about art and social justice, and I'm just going to play a clip of it for you now. I would say, just as I watched it, what really struck me was the juxtaposition of two quite different art forms, oratory on the one hand and documentary video on the other, and the way those two art forms are made to speak to each other in this piece, something I noticed. Second video, please.
Apparently more afraid of a ballot than a bullet. No, our work's not done. But if we are going to advance the cause of justice and equality and prosperity and freedom, then we also have to acknowledge that even if we eliminated every restriction on voting, we would still have one of the lowest voting rates among free peoples. That's not good. That is on us. And I am reminded of all those folks who had to count bubbles in a bar of soap, beaten trying to register voters in Mississippi, risk everything so that they could pull that lever. So if I hear anybody saying their vote does not matter, that it doesn't matter who we elect, read up on your history. It matters. We've got to get people to vote.
Stuart Weitzman, many of you think you know who Stuart is. Many of you may have worn your Stuart Weitzman shoes, knowing that you would see him here. But Stuart Weitzman is, in fact, these days an instructor at multiple Ivy League institutions at once, where he's teaching entrepreneurship. He is the curator currently he was the curator of an exhibit that is now on display at the New York Historical Society on the history of shoes. He is a collector of early and late Andy Warhol, and now a Broadway producer, and he also has a long career designing beautiful wearable art. I asked Stuart after I'd met him if he would consider filming with me for an episode on a poem by Robert Pinsky called Shirt, a poem that asks us to consider ordinary objects that we may not think of as art, but we are all connoisseurs of our own closets. And every morning, there's an exercise of a sort of craft that goes on as we choose what to wear. Here is Stuart leading off a discussion of Pinsky's Shirt.
When we buy something like a shoe or a shirt, we're only thinking of its future. When we're gonna wear it, where we're gonna wear it, what we're gonna wear it with. But a product like a handmade garment has a past.
Shirt. The back, the yoke, the yardage, lapped seams, the nearly invisible stitches along the collar turned in a sweatshop by Koreans or Malaysians gossiping over tea or noodles on their break, or talking money or politics, while one fitted this arm piece with its overseam to the band of cuff I button at my wrist.
I can see the similarities between creating this shirt and creating a poem.
What I think is unique about fashion, of all product design, is that it's touched by hand the whole time. There's somebody sewing every single seam. There's somebody attaching every single button, picking the size, picking the thread, picking the stitches per inch.
All of us every day put on these shirts and don't think anything about the process or the people that went into making it.
The whole poem is about human beings. That, to me, is the common thread.
Nice metaphor, Stuart. And finally, I'd like to introduce Paula Kerger, who is the head of PBS. When I asked, I hadn't met Paula until I invited her to be on this panel, and when I did, she sent me a very beautiful address she delivered recently on the power of the arts, and I was struck by her telling the story of being a little girl living in an out-of-the-way place where culture didn't come to her until it came, I think, through the mobile library that came to her small town. And what struck me in the video Paula chose for me, as well as how she chose to represent herself in a fairly formal address, was her emphasis on the little public, that is, on the public comprised of children, the public we wouldn't mistake for a polity or a citizenry yet. So this clip now chosen by Paula.
When I was 12 years old, I was watching great performances on PBS. This program with Nureyev came on. Nureyev in a performance of Le Corsaire, and I was amazed and awestruck. I really wanted to do it. I was street dancing at the time, and I never thought of formal dance until I saw great performances. I knew that I was really a novice to dance, like high dance. I decided to check out the High School Performing Arts. And so one thing led to the next. Today, as a recognized dancer, I absolutely believe that when I saw the performance, it affected me tremendously. And I know that's what happens when I teach. I'm opening an option for them that they hadn't seen before.
Stuart. Sorry.
You have to have the fundraiser.
I didn't mean it. We didn't mess with your video. Thank you. Thank you. So having provided us as a community with a reminder of what art feels like, I'm going to open with what might be a provocative question. I don't think it's that provocative, but you all can tell me. And that is the public to whom art is offered, is it the same as the polity or the citizenry? And this question occurred to me this morning because so much of our collective discourse is about politics. It is about a public that seems that we understand as essentially on one side or another. Are there publics to whom we reach out, to whom we try to move, who are in any way distinct from the polity? And I'm thinking of David and of Carrie too, whose art, as that we've seen here, certainly doesn't detach itself.
You know, my first instinct, it would be a shame to separate the political side of ourselves from the actual human being side. I had my life changed at a panel, which sort of feeds into this, reminds me of this panel. I'd done 1,000 panels at the Brookings Institute, the American Enterprise Institute, on scintillating topics like wither NATO and the future of entitlement spending. And I got invited to be on a panel at the Public Theater in New York, and early in my life I wanted to be a playwright. And on the panel was a bunch of actors. Anne Hathaway was on the panel, a great clown was on the panel, a bunch of theater people. And before the panel, we were off stage and we all got in a group hug and we all supported each other and we were all like leaning on each other's shoulders and Anne sang a song and then there were tissues on the stage in case we started crying. And then we got off the stage and we started gave another group hug. And it was so filled with emotion and team. And I realized I've been leading the wrong life. This is better than wither NATO. Uh-huh. And it symbolized to me a feature of our culture that we're over-politicized and under-moralized, that we talk constantly about every tweet and every little uptick in the polls, but the things that really matter are our relationships and whether we know what to do with suffering. And the only thing that can give you that kind of emotional knowledge is art. And so we have had a tendency to separate our brain and turn us into brains on a stick. And frankly, the institutions where we teach at Yale and Harvard, two elite institutions, one a little more elite, but we bring kids in because of their cognitive abilities. And it's part of a system of making us overly cognitive, underly relational, underly emotional.
It's so interesting, and I'm wondering what Carrie is thinking about that. Although I'm wondering as well, so I'm throwing another thing out here. I'm wondering about the relationship between art and ideas. We're here at an ideas festival. Is art separable from ideas? Maybe that's maybe either the prior question or that one would interest you, Carrie.
Totally committed to the exploration, first and foremost, of ideas. Of course, because that's what goes into the making of anything, right? You know, what are the ideas? And how are those? It seems to me that the thing that's really interesting, the question is, how do you shape the idea? How do you construct the idea in your field to make it work? And then to have a sort of open, dynamic, intense, glorious dialogue with anybody who's interested in engaging the process and the idea with you. So whether it's through video, photography, music, dance, sculpture, tap, shoes. Right, it's like, what shoes am I going to wear to sit next to Stuart?
You did not wear the right ones.
So all of that matters. I mean, I start almost every morning, looking at other artists, thinking about other artists, thinking about politics, thinking about the art of politics, and also the corruption of politics, and how to engage them in the work that I'm really deeply interested in making.
Would you mind saying one more word about how you execute or develop an idea in a piece of video such as we've just seen?
But, you know, one of the things this sort of question that, you know, the work that I'm doing right now is really deeply focused around the history of violence and the history of violence in the circus of politics. And that is my space. It's where I live, it's what I think about, it's constantly what I'm writing about, it's constantly what I'm teasing out and suffering for, right? But the bags under my eyes are enormous. How do we participate now in the process, in deepening and broadening and expanding notions of democracy? That's one of my questions, right, for myself. And so that's the issue, that's the question. How do I use voice? How do I use narrative? How do I use other voices? How do I pit those voices against something else? That Obama, of course, was a great orator, I thought was very important. That he was leaving office saying that fear and hope are still on the ballot, and that we have to bring out the dynamic public in order to push for this deeper democracy. That's still the work, and that's the way in which I sort of thought about using, in this case, the Obama.
But you also took a camera, and yes. you either stood on the street
Yes, on a great corner.
A number of times.
In my neighborhood in Flatbush Avenue. Going down Flatbush Avenue in Brooklyn, there's nothing like going down Flatbush Avenue in Brooklyn, New York. You encounter the world going down Flatbush Avenue, a fabulous, fabulous street. And so I thought that's all I needed to do. Just go set up on a street camera and just allow myself and my crew to just look at who is passing by, who's there. That I didn't need to invent the reality. The reality was there. And all I needed to do was to really think about how to make it. And so I use this material because I repurpose material all the time. I use it for this project. I've used the Obama, this visual material for other projects as well. It's sort of rich, I think, and quite useful.
Yeah, it's very beautiful, and thank you for indulging me by telling me about the process. I'm gonna ask one more question, and then I wanna ask Stuart about the material, the leather, the cork. Did you cut? Is that a continuous, what we saw?
No. It's shaped. It's shaped, yes. It's cut. There are, it's not a continuous run of footage.
So that the choice...
I actually design and edit.
Right, of course, yes. So, but the choice of whom we saw...
Didn't work for me.
The choice of whom we saw, whether someone was on their phone, whether that person was wearing a turban, these were choices that we would all make.
Yes. Yes and no. In other words, they were there, and it was simply a matter of crafting it mm-hmm. in such a way that you see certain things at certain times to sort of underscore. But the thing that's really interesting, it's sort of like having a really great piece of music. At a certain moment, it really doesn't matter what the image is, because the image is always stimulating. The image is always interesting. The image, people are always fascinating. People are always fascinating, so it really doesn't matter. I don't really sort of worry so much about whether or not, when they say immigrant, am I seeing like a man with a turban? It simply happened to work that way. Mm-hmm. But there are also sort of repetitive ideas. There are in your text, in your work, there are these ideas that you're coming back to again and again and again and again and again. It's not like, every day there are another 15,000 different thoughts or ideas. Rather, what you're doing constantly is mining the essence of the core of your ideas. What are the things that you are most deeply concerned about? And how do those things get articulated today in a way that they won't necessarily be articulated tomorrow, but hopefully what the thing is that the work is allowing you to spin more deeply and more compassionately and more focused and more openly into what your process is, what your ideas really are. And I think that that's the thing that really brings all of us together, this sense that we are deeply committed to an idea that is rooted in notions of social justice and in notions of democracy. And how do you tease that out contemporarily with the work that you're doing now?
Might I add also to notions of human well-being that can be very simple to notions of beauty. Frost says the poem begins in delight and ends in wisdom. And I actually have, since knowing Stuart, come to think a lot more about footwear. Our feet are what hold us up in the world. And they are, everyone, we all recognize the power of faces. We may not be as attentive as we ought to be. Although on our yoga mats, we are reminded of our feet. But as I've gotten to know Stuart, I've come to think more about a functional item that defines our gender, our right to comfort versus our not belonging to those who are owed comfort. I warned Stuart that I might ask him what was the social justice takeaway from going to see his exhibit at the New York Historical Society on the history of shoes. And he didn't say, don't ask me that, I don't have an answer.
No, actually, I'm suggesting you go see that exhibit.
I will. I will.
I might seem like the odd man out here on this panel, you know, but while you all are reminding us of how difficult things are in the world and in America and the suffering, and I guess brings a little sadness to all of us when we read and visualize it, I'm here to make you happy. I have to put you in the mood so that you will accept the logic and the understanding and the guidance from people like David and Carrie. And footwear or any other fashion product that gives you an uplifting spirit is basically made for that purpose. I would think that less than 5% of what is bought to be worn is bought to be worn solely for its function, but also for its beauty. And I thank you for confirming that wearable art is an art form. I often make that point. And at that exhibit at the New York Historical Society, which is a collection of several hundred pairs of old shoes going back this 1900s, the flapper years, up to about the beginning of World War II, there's a lot to be learned. The first thing you can't miss is that shoes, even today, but going back then, were more so a reflection of who the person was that wore them. You could not wear, for example, in Louis XIV's court, a heel higher than he wore. By the way, ladies, he started the high heel. He was too short for the rest of his court, and he wanted to tower over them. And then there were heights that you'll see in the show that the queen could wear and other dukes and duchesses could wear. And don't you dare, I guess they would guillotine your foot to get rid of some of the height if you violated those traditions. And our industry, and I learned this in studying the footwear to present it, to curate it, our industry is the first industry to create a labor union for women called the Boot and Shoe Recorders Union of Lynn, Massachusetts, 1858, way before Gompers and all the union movement, and they prospered with it. And I remember the few years I had in my father's shoe factory in Haverhill, Massachusetts, as equal pay or more so for the women who stitched the shoes than the men who attached the heels. And that was because the talent required for what they did was more important than training anyone to nail a heel on. And the union made that happen. Mm-hmm. And when you, I mean, I will tell you something. We just saw a little clip of the poem Shirt. I had never seen that poem. And I suppose Lisa picked it because there's no poem on shoes. So this was the closest
I looked.
She did look, I know, because I gave her the challenge. But I'm glad you found Pinsky's poem. And it, if you read it, you will never think of a shoe or a shirt or anything like that in the same way again. Like we said, it has a past. And the sweatshop he refers to, the guidelines that these objects of art in shoes and shirts and others and similar things gave us on how to build a factory and run a factory. I mean, the people that he tells us describes how they died in that fire in New York in 1911. He puts you there, he transposes you there. And that is in everything that I do. I didn't go to China to make shoes when the American industry ended because I didn't want to continue the sweatshop. I went to Spain, which was in the European community, which has tougher laws and better laws than we do to protect people who are working. And they are toiling and sacrificing to make what we're wearing. And I think of it every day because of that poem. And I don't know that it was so on my mind. And it was taken for granted because I was in the industry. But I say, read Shirt. You will never think of your blouse in the same way again. By the way, about an idea, that's how all design starts, mm-hmm. in fashion as well. We don't design a shoe. We design a concept. Mm-hmm. And then we build into that concept, just as you do. And we want to make a statement, and we do it. And you will see at that exhibit two shoes. This is really wonderful. Did I bring them to Harvard, the shoes that the girls...
You brought amazing shoes to Harvard.
I ran a contest for all New York high school students, 300,000. And they had to draw a shoe in five different positions, including the sole, as that's a very important element today in design, and present it. And we had a winner. Actually, there were two great shoes, and I gave two girls winners. One was from the School of Design and Art. The other was from Chapin. And these two girls, one designed a shoe that's, I nicknamed Strange Fruit, Billie Holiday's song.
Heels or flats?
It's a wedge. And she created this artistic shoe, which we're actually have shown to Oprah, and she may make a statement with this shoe, that has diamonds hanging from the heel. This is a 15-year-old girl who said, I couldn't hang a black man, but their lives were like diamonds. You won't believe this shoe. Yeah. And the design of it itself, without the political message, is gorgeous. I mean, my daughter said, Daddy, hire her, you know? And the other girl who came from a Middle Eastern country where women can't be educated at all when she was a child, today it's still very limited, she created a shoe called Education for All, and she made a heel out of three books, of course, carved out of wood. It's so fabulous. I know it would be
you
a seller. It is an amazing shoe. If you're at my 12 o'clock, they'll be there. And on the straps, you know, like you're wearing, newspapers, and Education for All. And that is some message. I've never made a shoe that could give that kind of message. But it brought it out of kids who really aren't designers, but they are.
Lovely.
Speaking of kids and art, and I'm thinking especially of public television as it nurtures an audience, it nurtures and teaches. We haven't really, at least explicitly, asked the question, ought art teach? Right? Is it are artists didactic? And I'd love to hear from you, Paula. I'm sure everybody would on, I don't know, the developmental arc as you all see it in at PBS. There are I know from some of my own viewers that certainly many of them are lifelong learners, as we now call them. It's often an older audience that was not exposed to the explosion of media that my children now are, and the kids, and it's, I think, increasingly myself as someone who's not only educating 18 to 21 year olds these days, I think about the richness in those populations, the curiosity, and the sort of openness to ideas.
Well, it's a pleasure to be on this panel, and I actually am the outlier because I'm the arts enabler. You all, the rest of you are all artists, but I think about this all the time because I think the role that public broadcasting plays across the country is to provide access. That's why I love Desmond's story. Here is a young man who grew up in the shadow of New York, where there's just such an abundance of amazing art. And he had a singular experience that transformed his life through a medium that one doesn't always think of as appealing to one's higher aspirations, television, right? And as we have thought over the years, I think of my own experience and the story that I had shared with you from the Blashfield Address. I grew up outside of Baltimore. We would occasionally travel into town to go to the museums or to see a play, but really my access was television. And my access was also a great public school education where art was taught. And I think that so much of what defines us as human is our desire to express ourselves. And I am not an artist. If one sees my drawings or hears me in the shower, one fully appreciates that I'm not an artist. But I still have that same impulse. And I think that to be able to reach people through great art, which I think teaches empathy and compassion and innovation and creativity, that is obviously tied to our ability to express oneself, but it really carries through our entire life. You know, and that mindfulness of experiencing great art and how that transports us. I mean, that's what we think about in the work that we produce. And so for the youngest children, I sent you a wonderful clip that you didn't share, because I sent you too many. Esperanza Spalding, the great jazz musician, you know, saw Yo-Yo Ma on Mr. Rogers and had never seen a cello before. And that was her inspirational moment. So I think that, you know, if you have this powerful platform of television that reaches into every home, homes that may not have books or computers, for kids that may not have access, the ability to just show a wider world, I think, is huge. And that extends to whether you're 3 or 4 or 5 or 55. You know, I think we continue to look for these opportunities to learn and grow. And I think that, you know, to be able to seize television as a medium or digital as a medium. It's also a powerful storytelling tool. Just participated in a project that was not connected to public television that was organized by a guy. It was an international competition where kids from the age of 12 to 22, so you talk about wasting your time with kids, 12 to 22, we're enabled to submit a video that told a story that was impactful to them. It was Film Your Voice, was the name of the competition. I am telling you, and you can go on YouTube and look at the 15 finalists, it is the most powerful, impactful storytelling that I have seen in a long time. Mm-hmm. And some of the films were indeed done by 12-year-olds, right, competing against 22-year-olds. Some of them were animations. There's an animation from a young man in India that talked about his mother who suffers from mental illness and how that impacts him, all done through animation. Hugely powerful. Skill of the storytelling as well as the medium he chose, just beautifully woven together. But probably the most impactful was a young woman from England who suffers from cerebral palsy who dreams of being a filmmaker but is restricted to her home because she can't travel, but has this amazing need to create and tell story, straight to camera, just telling her story of who she is, who she aspires to be. I mean, I can't think of a more transformational piece of film than I've seen in a long time than just this woman t- telling a story. And these are all tools that any kid can access. Mm-hmm. So I think this whole idea of opening a world where people can show and tell and share, and using the power of television as a broadcast media or a digital that connects us all, I think is really an amazingly powerful part of life.
I think that we are, it's time to take some questions, even though I have some more of my own. We'd love to hear from those of you in the audience. Here you go.
Hi, my name is David Lee. One of the most frightening words that I keep hearing come down the pike is STEM. And I'm wondering, and basically talking about an education where you focus on the sciences, technology, electronics, and...
Math.
Math, thank you. That's great. That's really wonderful. Why isn't it STEAM? It seems like we in the arts have abrogated our responsibility to really fight for that. You've all talked about very articulately how important the arts are, and it's true. What do we, as people in the arts, do to stop this cutting of our educational arts, of telling college kids that the only thing of value is getting a job when you get out, which arts is pretty iffy, but it's no reason not to do it if it's your passion. Do any of you have thoughts on that?
I have a lot of thoughts about this because obviously, you know, STEAM is more relevant than STEM because there's so much brain research that shows that, you know, an arts education as beginning as minds are being formed. I mean, we spend a lot of time developing programs for very, very young children that all integrate art because it increases the stickiness of the learning. I mean, Fred Rogers knew that. That's if you watch a Fred Rogers program that was produced 50 years ago, he knew that if you had a lesson and then you reinforced it with music, kids would remember it. But it also helps in the way that the brains are wired. You know, music and art and math are all completely related to each other. And so I think that this idea that somehow a well-rounded education is only for, you know, college is not trade school. And I spend a lot of time on college campuses, and to me, the most disturbing conversations I have with kids who are in liberal arts schools who think they've made a big mistake because the media keeps telling them that they're never going to get a job and that they're wasting their time. And these are the kids I want to hire. I want to hire kids that have gone to school and learned critical thinking, that really have the skills for the future are all the skills of artists. Those are the skills that aren't going to be outsourced. Kids that know how to speak and know how to express themselves and that are creative, that all is very much a part of an education. And I think all of us, whether we work in the arts or we work in any other field, have a great obligation to those kids coming up that they get the kind of education that actually is going to serve them well, not only as contributing members of society, but as in also fulfilling their own selves.
Yes, how we give scope to the creatives among us, and I think most of us in some corner of our soul think of ourselves as creatives. It is remarkable how little cultural space is given to the idea that pursuing one's creativity over a lifetime is a valuable valuable ambition. And yet, who among us wouldn't prefer to walk down to the river with music coming through earbuds? Our human craving for beauty, for emotional release is visible, is manifest, just in as we watch each other go around the world. There's an odd miscalculation. I have in some ways allowed for the peer, I've studied 18 to 21 year olds for a long time, and I have come to believe that while I am seeding something that may blossom later, for most of them. I am not the main show in their lives. They are falling in love and getting sad, and they are figuring out vocationally. They're figuring out how to, you know, put toast in the toaster. They have a lot of jobs to do, and that experience of enlightenment that that you despair we're not giving to smaller children, I kind of think we should be focusing on them, right? On those younger years instead of cramming it all in.
But
Carrie.
But there's something else I think that that is also sort of fascinating and interesting, and that is that we've entered a new moment in time, right? Where we are involved in culture and in the arts and with various aspects of the arts in ways that we never were before, right? Museums are developing all over the country. There are more festivals all over the world. Whatever festival you can think of in relationship to the arts is happening. It's happening right now, right here, at this moment, at this hour, right? I mean, they're happening all over. So that there's this huge kind of shift that's sort of taking place where we're all involved in one way in this idea of sort of cultural production, cultural industry, right? New, again, new institutions, new museums, new institutes. What's that about, right? What is that about? At the same moment that we can sort of talk about, you know, students feeling like I've really made a mistake. So I've gotten like a degree in sculpture. I mean, like, what am I going to do with this, right? And so there's something. You're a program with young kids. Sort of the ways in which we use these sort of amazing tools of social media, of social engagement, of Facebook and Instagram and YouTube, all of these sort of platforms for this extraordinary kind of explosion that's going on within aspects of cultural production.
Including the newspaper.
I think that this is really sort of an interesting time, and I was wondering what you were thinking about that, David.
Well, too. College may be the wrong time to think about, because it's a whole industry based on the anxiety of parents.
Yes.
And so I just, once I left, one of my students come up to me and say, you know, I really want to major in accounting, but my parents are forcing me to major in art history. And that, like, that'll never happen.
Oh, that's hilarious.
But so it's great. The parental pressure. But I think they're hungry for it. One of the best compliments I got from one of my students it was about how to lead a life of meaning, the course. And at the end he said, your class has made me so much sadder. And that was a total win, because I'd introduce something. Actually, I'm listening to the conversation, if I could just take my 25 seconds. Because I sort of straddle both the bad part of culture, the shallow part, and hopefully a little of the richer part. So like today, I have two projects that I'm going back to my room to work on. The one is a column on should conservatives leave the Republican Party. And that's not art, that's rhetoric.
Should they leave
the Republican Party, because it's not a conservative party. Uh-huh. So that's like rhetoric and an argument. Uh-huh. It's not art. This evening at 5:30 at the St. Regis Ballroom, I'll be giving a talk on something else, something that means a lot more to me. And that talk approaches art, because the way I'm thinking of structuring the talk, is I'll start with humor to establish a relationship with the audience. Then I'll have a romantic story to open up the hearts of the audience. Then I'll have a story of moral uplift. And so it's to raise people up, to have a series of emotions. And then I'm going to talk about the current sociological realities, which brings them back down. And then I'm going to end by talking about the people who are really making America recover, community builders and such. So it has an emotional arc. And when I give my speeches, it feels a little more like art. And frankly, I model my speeches on Bruce Springsteen concerts and the emotional arc that he creates. Mine are not as good, but he's got good guitar. But I find myself straddling these two worlds. And frankly, in my life, all the professional pressures are to be on the shallow, argumentative political side and not on the realm of emotion. And the two things that art gives us, one is the power to see clearly, like seeing a shirt clearly. It reshapes how we see things, and then it educates our emotions. Taylor Swift, I saw her on 60 Minutes, and the questioner said, a lot of your songs are sad. And she said, well, actually, there are 27 kinds of sadness. And there's your boyfriend dumps you sadness, and she played a little tune. You lost your dog sadness, she plays a different tune. Your mom is mad at you sadness. She's an expert at sadness. Mm-hmm. And that's emotional experience and artistic experience gives you that curriculum of emotion.
And all of the nuance. and the texture that we lose. Do we have, I think we have time for a few more, yes.
Zero, zero, zero.
Do I need a microphone? Can I just speak?
Shout.
Shout.
So,
no, you need a microphone.
Thank you for letting me join this dialogue. I'm a therapist, so I'm interested in relationship. I'm a Buddhist practitioner, so I'm interested in what you're talking about awareness. I'm a human being, so I'm interested in personal expression. But one thing I'm not hearing here with social justice is about power and about the roles that give you power, whether you're an artist or whether you're a columnist, and how can we begin to have more awareness about the impact of these roles and begin to break down this power structure so that voices become able to be in the dialogue. I mean, I've been sitting here thinking, I want to join this dialogue, but I don't have the role equal to yours. So I think awareness of that, and I just have a question for you about that. In art, there is a huge power. I was an art history major. There's a huge power structure to even getting your art looked at. And how can we begin to create equality in expression? How can we begin to open this up and have awareness in our roles as leaders, in our roles as wealthy people, in our roles as well-educated people? So that's my question for you.
Question.
Well, it's a very big one. Huge, expansive, huge question. But I think, you know, I was talking with a young boy called me the other day, he wants to be an artist, or he is an artist, and he's struggling, and we were talking, and his father introduced him to me. And I was asking him about, you know, these ideas again about, well, what concerns you, and what are you committed to? And then I told him a little bit about myself. And one of the things that I told him about myself was that I think that my project, my large project, my life's project is about awareness and power. What is power? How do you look at it? How do you deconstruct it? How do you engage it? How do you negotiate it? How do you hide from it? How do you, you know, deconstruct it? And so, and all of the work that I'm making in one way or another, it is through that lens. And so the work that I'm really interested in doing right now is in bringing together another group of artists to look at this issue of democracy and power as we lead into the 2020 election cycle. How are artists thinking about these questions? How do we raise these questions? And then how do we, not simply, you know, what is awareness, but then how do you disseminate ideas? What are the means by which somebody can engage these questions along with you? And that's, of course, that's sort of the larger issue. The question of awareness, the question of who we are, who has voice, who's heard, under what circumstances are they heard, is, of course, at the heart of this project that you are actually talking
Absolutely.
About. And I mean, your question allows us to think about the adequacy or inadequacy of the institutions that we belong to, newspapers, large public television organizations, universities, the world of commerce, the art world, and whether those institutions are open enough, are porous enough, or are just inventive enough. And I it seems to me this is a panel of people who are all sort of odd in a good way, that is, pressing, you know, and I come back to David, who offers these pithy little lessons within columns, as if he's writing, you know, for the Spectator in the 18th century, for the coffee house, for a, really an idea of an educated citizenry, that we are all in our ways endeavoring to open up space to find new audiences seems to me an inadequate answer to your question that is the right one. Do we have time for one?
No, we're out of time.
Thank you all so much.